phase, sorry, you have to go to handling phase. Okay. And how familiar are you with AdTech in general? Are you familiar? I'm sure you all have seen AdTech from not to India, you know what goes behind the scenes there. So, we'll cover some of that.
So, like you mentioned, that the top three covers don't have to be two parts. The first is how we are applying machine learning in AdTech and how we are doing how we are applying machine learning at PubMatic. Okay. These are real world examples of how we are applying machine learning at scale. And then the second part is where Hari Satish is going to speak about using them cases on Facebook to develop project. Just to give you some background, PubMatic is a release self-signed platform that helps publishers realize the full potential of their digital assets. So we power up automation.
And to provide some more context, what we do is we run real-time opportunities for over 60 billion ads a day. So we see 60 billion ad requests a day. You then send these bids to potential buyers who are interested in buying a particular ad. There will be tens or hundreds of different buyers in the world.
Interested in buying a particular ad question. And that corresponds to actually streams of advertiser bids that are being processed every month. And just in a sense, we have around 400 terabytes of data being generated in a single day.
And this is the scale at which we are currently applying machine learning. So
this,
yes,
200 GB is like what, compressed data?
No, this is uncompressed data, yes.
It's actually 200 GB, I think it's slightly older, but there are 200 GB of compressed
data today, right? It's roughly at least a few hundred, let's say around 100 terabytes of compressed
data. These are just aggregations.
Yes, this is just aggregations, so 50 to 60 billion aggregations every single day, and then each bit. So each application corresponds to bids. So think of it like a stock exchange where, you know, every somebody comes in and says this is an ad to our store, and then there will be tens or hundreds of buyers that have potentially interested in that application. So each of that becomes a transaction. So you kind of make real time. We come to that in a little bit, but we make real time calls to all of the buyers saying how much are you interested in bidding for this application and process that data. So that corresponds to.
Maybe you can assume, let's say, an average of say 50. What I say, bids per impression, you would end up with 300 million kind of
impression. Sorry, 300 bids. Each of these bids has a lot of information, like what is bid value, which is impression come from, which user didn't come from, all of that stuff. So,
all that is a transaction for us. So, as you can imagine, all of this is running at extremely large scale,
and as billions of impressions, hundreds of bids per second. There can only be one bidder for every single impression. So you just serve one ad and one of the bidders on that particular bid to serve that particular impression. And this means that you are running massive amounts of infrastructure. Think about the number of connections that you need to establish. Each of these bids need to be processed in 20 milliseconds. That's the time that we have to process every single transaction. And there are hundreds of parameters to evaluate in runtime, and all of this happens at
so one of the problems that we have faced is scattering infrastructure costs, not just for us, but also the bids that we're sending out to the partners. There is huge amount of infrastructure that they need to provision to send to all the bids and requests that we're sending to them. So one of the things is where you apply machine learning is to learn and predict which buyers are likely to bid on the impression and who are most likely to bid on the impression. So what that does is different buyers are looking for different things, right? Different buyers will be looking for some buyers will be looking for specific audiences, others will be looking for a different audience, somebody will be looking for specific impressions coming from specific geography because that's where they are in their business, somebody else should be in their business location. So every buyer is different in what they are looking for. And your machine learning algorithms are being applied to predict what is of interest for a particular buyer, who is likely to buy a particular impression, and such a business. And what we've done is by implementing reducing the number of bids, increase the efficiency for both people who are listening to those requests from us, the buyers, as well as it lowers the cost of infrastructure that is needed to support that. And in our real world example, we can see that even after reducing the number of requests per second that we send out to the partners,
we have seen improved bid rate because now intelligent insight improves and the bid to not just everyone.
And we have seen more spend coming for QPS.
QPS is queries per second or request per second.
Another use case that we can apply machine learning at scale and PubMatic, or even in AdTech.
So, all this applies in general to AdTech and PubMatic as well.
But one of them is price prediction and revenue optimization.
So, here what we are doing is we are trying to predict value of the impression rate. What is the value of the impression coming from a particular user, from a particular geography, at a particular time and date? We try to predict the value of what is the bid or what the highest bid would look like. And once we determine, and then we use that as base price as an option. Like I said, we run the real time option. All the bids come in from all the buyers and the option set use. Like it puts supposed to regulation a lot of rules and get back. So machine learning is used to predict the value of the impression rate. Validation predicted is used as a tool.
And it's a very complex problem given that there are large number of variables that come into play.
So some of the variables could be like say, time variable. But typically you see bids that are definitely low versus bids that are 9 a.m. are going to be much higher than the bid at 12 at night. Bids from specific geographies are usually higher, let's say ECTMs are usually higher than the US compared to the same India. There could be different demand landscape, there could be different buyers who are interested in buying anything. Some users are inherently more valuable than others. Certain websites or properties are inherently more valuable than others. For example, if you're reading newspaper, the value of CPMs there will be much higher than, say, what somebody is going to get with some job that is not getting possible. So there are a lot of factors that come in together and that affect the price of impression. And your machine learning is really helps us to figure out what the right price for impression should be. And that helps increase the publisher's revenue. And it has improved yield and has also resulted in even not something understanding or like buying it or really cheap. Let's say impression is supposed to be fairly valued at $1. We don't want someone to just go and buy it at the same prices. So it helps with the price protection, clarity, and thing as well as improved yield.
I have two questions. First is whether I am implementing this as a streaming service or just one model is deployed there and it is used for
the same. It is not streaming today. It is batch which is updated every few hours. They are looking to kind of reduce the batch movement to a real time. As in, the models are built offline and then fed into a real time ad processing stage. So the 20 milliseconds are the same. That actually look up the model and calls the predictor of the model and uses the model in real time. All the 20 milliseconds I'm speaking of processing time or decision making time that we have actually applies every single impression, every single of those 60 million impressions that we see. Models are made. Just the models are being created every few hours, or rather they're being completed every few hours and being made up.
What is the latency? Latency?
A couple of milliseconds at max for looking up the models. Another use case, so we covered two use cases. One of them, like both of them were kind of prediction problems. One was infrastructure optimization, the other was around predicting what the value of impression would be. The third very common use case is around segmenting users or audiences and doing lookalike audiences. So, audience segmentation is basically every buyer is interested in looking for specific kind of audiences, segmenting your audiences. So, kind of sports rather than company, I would just reach out to users who are interested in sports. If I am, let's say, a builder, I would reach out to people looking to buy a house. Or if a car manufacturer, I would reach out to people who are looking to buy a car. And every time you see an impression, you get a lot of signals from that impression or belonging to that user. You know, what the user is, the site they're visiting, what time they're visiting, what's the content on the page. All of those kind of go into the model to figure out, so what is the user likely to be interested in? And what the user likely to be interested in purchasing? There's an intent behavior somewhere.
And that
helps not only the buyer, but it also helps users, it comes as users, consumers on the online internet. You want to see more relevant ads, you want to see ads that are inventory review that you don't care about. Right? So this helps personalizing the ads that are being rendered or delivered. And lookalike models are very similar in the sense that buyers know the data of the customer that this is the kind of user that I am interested in going on that. But usually buyers know, or they know the user audiences that are performing very well for that. So this may be a very small number. And these models can be used for other these user, high performing users or audiences. Like users see the model to come up with a lookalike of effect and increases the scale at which these impressions are made available to the buyer. So let's say today without any lookalike model is unable to reach an audience of 100 users. By using lookalike models, I'm able to identify more users or more customers that I do not know exist, but they exhibit similar characteristics to the high performing users or customers that I have. And then that is used to increase the scale of the network. More users, but similar set of users to the ones that I have already seen.
And there are some correlations, for example, given the fact data science may apply, identify correlations between two users, right? How two
users are similar to each other and what characteristics do they exhibit. And sometimes it's not very intuitive. So, for example, if let's say I'm a web hosting company and I'm looking to reach out to users who may be a potential customer, what I would think is I should be reaching out to our customer ads to business owners because they are the ones who would typically come and create a website, buy a domain name, and increase my business. But what you can see is that some of the correlations are not usually included. It's not actually business owners who enter my domain, it is usually the web designers or web developers who actually go and register and sign up for it. So, while as a business, you may think I should be reaching business users or selling business owners, but what I can actually do is target web developers or they're the ones who are your customers.
So mining really helps filter out those kind of situations that you may not really want this some additional use cases. We use machine learning and NLP a lot for chatbots and also kind of as you said, the base is there, so if the user comes in and it's a particular report and they say, show me how my campaigns are performing in the past 7 days in a particular geography. They don't come in and build a report using multiple clicks and stuff. They just come in and type like you would normally do, say, so we might talk advertisers or my top performing campaign in the last 7 days from the United States or something. And that information will get processed and you see that this exact report that you were looking to do.
Chatbots is again something that we are experimenting with to figure out how to help users find information that they are looking to access in a more intuitive manner, right? They don't have to go and search and stuff, it will just back and forth.
Another area of machine learning is fraud protection and identifying human and non-human traffic.
So for those of you who are not familiar with AdTech, there are a lot of bots, so a lot of traffic gets generated by non-human traffic. Machine generated traffic just increase monetization for the company. Is this traffic that is coming, is it human or non-human traffic? Because buyers obviously don't want to pay for non-human traffic because that's a waste of money, they're not analyzing what we do that.
A couple of other classical problems of machine learning that have come right in AdTech today. One is forecasting.
Like, figure out how many impressions, like, previously there were use cases that were discussed, like, that were very similar to forecasting use case. In AdTech, the use case is to figure out how many impressions, let's say, are going to be available for a given campaign, for a given targeting criteria, how many users can I go to reach, how many impressions can I sell.
The classic machine learning problem for forecasting, being on the right track.
And quick prediction. At the end of the day, buyers usually care, they're spending money on ads, so that users actually click on those ads and they're buying their products. So, machine learning can be applied to figure out what the probability of a user clicking on a particular ad. And or performing an action that you use, that the buyer wants the user to perform. It could be downloading an app, installing an app, buying some product, doing it with these for different products.
So, the next is machine learning for intelligent risk routing at scale. That's more of an infrastructure optimization problem, including efficiency of the entire ecosystem. Price prediction is revenue optimization for publishers. Which is a pure lift yield kind of problem. Audience segmentation is utilized only. Bot chats and LP being used for interfaces.
fraud detection to differentiate between human and non-human target.
Forecasting,
figure out how the campaign will deliver, so that I will be looking at campaign hard.
That becomes a lot more complex.
If you have a lot of campaigns where you can simultaneously, so you take a mixed campaign overlapping each other, figure out what should be hopeful for people, and keep predicting what should be the user. That's all I have in the first part, and then I'll hand it over to Satish to speak about using some cases.
Thank you, Dinesh.
Thank you.
So, thanks, Dinesh. So, today in this part, I am going to cover further using some cases of human project. So, I assume like most of us here are data scientists and must have gone through a data science project and must have gone through all these phases of a MM project. So, here I am going to share about whatever musings or whatever learnings or thoughts we have on the phases of MM project which we have learned after applying MM in that. So, the first phase of this is understanding problem and research. So, the key thoughts here are when we get the requirements, we should always define the final scope in a quantitative statement. So, what I mean by a quantitative statement is should come up as a final expectation, saying like I should be able to predict 90% of users who are going to click my ad in next 2 months. So, and with an accuracy of 25%, or a false positive rate of 25%. So, what this gives you is a clear goal when you do a machine learning that this is my stopping point or this is something I would have to attain as a result of this MM project. The second thing is define the lower and upper bound. What I mean by that is we all know like all models have a null model everywhere. Null model is a basic model which you run. So, for example, if we have a classifier or a basic binomial kind of zero kind of situation, we all know the reason which is happening maximum times if the classifier grades that always, we will have that much of minimum accuracy. So that is the lower bound or a null model for my machine learning problem. And we can also get an upper bound. So upper bound is defined by a base rate. What this base rate says is the amount of unexplained variance which you have. Even if you include all the variables which are available, still if you can't define the output variable by, that is the unexplained variance which you have. So that defines the upper bound. So whatever you do, whatever algorithms you use or whatever iterations or hyperparameter tunings you do, you will reach only that. So knowing that is quite a times difficult, but if you can get that, you will get an idea of when you should stop. And complete your machine learning project or redefine some other things. And the final thought here is we should always search the domain. So we as a data scientist sometimes when we get the data, we always want to like we just plot it, do it over it, run some machine learning over it. But the most important key thing here is searching the domain. For example, unless otherwise you understand, this is an example of understanding domain. Unless you understand, like for example, ad domain, you won't understand any of the jargons or the things which we do. For example, Dinesh talked about bit throttling. So, if you don't know what bit throttling means and what are these implications over it, whatever model you do, what the answer you get may not make sense. Right? For example, what is the expectation of bit throttling? Should it increase my revenue, decrease my revenue, or give a proper result? So, that is something we only get to know once we understand the domain in depth. For example, remarketing is a very general term, but it has a very specific meaning in AdTech. It means like it's only a user who has already been to our website and has a cookie store installed on that browser. So that is the user only whom we can remarket or retarget. So the definition, general definition, you know, changes with the context and application in the domain. You must always take care and give a proper time in researching the domain. So the next part is data acquisition and then understanding the key. The key part here is correlation is a very important metric and we should always go with it. Is something is affecting my final result or something. But we should always be aware of the Simpson's paradox. What this paradox is comparing two things, the correlation will only show me correct results considering all other things are same. Right? For example, if I am comparing two users in AdTech, I should compare that all other things remain same. So there's a proper, there's a very famous example which happened in UC Berkeley in the fall of 1973, where there was a legal action against the UC Berkeley, saying they were biased towards giving more admission towards men as compared to women. But this was done with the basic stats, like how many students were got admitted to UC Berkeley. But finally, when they actually did a comparison department-wise, they actually found that there were more women which actually got admitted department-wise as compared to women. So the main the paradox here was women were applying to departments which were very competitive and in which very few people get in. So that was the basic paradox. So we always correlate, but we should understand like are we correlating it in the paradox. So the next again thought here is we should always showcase our descriptive to clients. So as an engineers or data science people, we always want to get something good out and then only show to the client customer. But this is a wrong thing, and we should always show our initial descriptive or analysis which we do on our data to the client, so that we understand what we have learned is making sense in the domain, or we can ask domain expert like what we are correlating or what we are understanding from descriptive, is it actually making sense in the context. So this is a very key thing. Unless we go on this, and if we go wrong on this, we might be building a beautiful model, but it would be useless. So again, then, showing the examples of how again we should always in many cases we would also have to aggregate our pivot data. So what this essentially means, for example, in AdTech, as we said, like we receive 60 billion impressions. So, but each impression is independent. So you can't run machine learning over it because it has very little sense in it. So you have to aggregate your pivot on something. Like for example, if you are interested in pivoting the conversion or the prediction, you will pivot on user and then get all his characteristics. Or you may want to pivot on some website or the publisher or advertiser and then got this information, and then you will do machine learning on that. So as you can see, there are so many, like in PubMatic we log more than 500 different fields. So each different fields have different meanings, and some of them proxy for each other, some of them are not public also. So important thoughts are whenever you do data analysis and after the lending acquisition, you do understand it. You might want to even cluster the data to understand which all fields are related and which can proxy for other, and maybe include fewer features so that you have lesser features to process in the final model as compared to if you are just taking the number of all the fields and giving it to the machine learning. Also, the important thing even in AdTech is most of the fields are not logged for all the cases. Like for example, the mobile app ID, the location, and there are various reasons for that. But when we get data, we should analyze like what is how much data we are getting. Like for example, if you are getting mobile app details or location details, only 5% of the fraud. You can't build model using location numbers. You can't do anything about it. So the other option is to impute. There are cases where we can impute data from IP and other things. So we would have to avail to that before we do that. So the next famous step is for when we get into advertiser modeling. So I would strongly recommend that we should always build a business-oriented advertiser before we even move into modeling. This is important because building advertisers would help us to get the clear understanding of the business, and we should always review these hypotheses again with the client, so that we understand that we are not losing anything basic here, or we are not doing wrong which is not correct in the context of the business we are. So also while choosing modeling technique, we always go ahead and say like which is the best model. Like for example, if I had like classification algorithms, say okay, I have seen these are random forests, random forests superior, I would go for random forest. But this doesn't always work. For example, even PubMatic, when we had a classification issue, we tried more random and decision. But what we found was decision tree was giving us the similar result as random forest with the difference of accuracy of plus 5 minus 5%. So that was okay for our business as soon as it is giving us within our SLA. So choosing model has to be always considered using the deployment or how we are to implement this model in production. So once you build the models, you have to then obviously compare it with the null model, and you should always, as I said, you should know always when to stop and when to go ahead. Giving an example, in PubMatic, we always have the problem of knowing the cardinality of fields, like how many unique values this field or feature can have. So that is again a tricky problem considering billion impressions. You need to always have like so many unique things which come up. So instead of going through all, we use hyperlog approximation, which gives us a better idea of what are the cardinalities, but in a very short time. So rather than using complex algorithms, we always approximate and do things. So we know when to stop considering the trade-off, like is doing more thing, is worth the effort. Like I'm okay with 5-10% of error rate, but still it is giving 5% results for business, then obviously we should know there and stop there. So the final thing part which we have is not the final, but I think it's the most important part of machine learning is presenting the model. You know, like Ajay Naman said, like we should have to be complicated. So storytelling and presenting is very important. There's a thought for me, like as Unix, you should not need a genius to understand simplicity of the model. The model should be communicated in a simplistic way. And we should avoid using any technical or statistical patterns, and even try to use some of the domain level language so that the business or the end users we are presenting to can make better connect with the presentation and they can better understand. So, giving an example, like charting is always the best thing, and we obviously use lift and gain charts. So, what these lift and gain charts say is like how much gain you are getting by exposing it to how much customer. Like it says you can identify and target 88% of customers who are likely to convert by using only advertising only 20% of the population. So this is what your performance of model is. The black line shows the baseline if you did have model of how it will do, and the lift and the curve gain shows you like how much benefit you have. So the question the management always asks for that. How much revenue impact do we have? Whatever model we show them, the first question to us is how much revenue do we gain from it? Or how much revenue we are saving from it? So this is where you just connect in their language saying like we are able to reach not 100 but 88% of people, but with only just 20% of people who we are talking. So this is the way I think you can connect with the business and showcase them the model into their language. And then last important thing is how should we go about deployment and operation. So sometimes even mesh models don't get deployed in production. So for as we know as Dinesh mentioned, like in PubMatic and AdTech, we have under like 200 milliseconds to complete a real-time bidding process. So this is a complex process where you send bids to advertisers, get their response, do the bidding, their pricing, and finally showcase their results. So by the time you log into your Google or Yahoo or Times of India, you don't see a delay. So that is what we do in background in under 200 milliseconds. So if we are considering model building here or applying machine learning, even the predict method cannot take less than like 10 milliseconds for us. So that is very crucial to understand. Like even if you build the best model, you have to consider the deployment statistics, like what should be the SLA, what is the output format, how should the data structure. So these are very critical requirements, and even an example of an Amazon, even a 1 second page load is delay causes Amazon around $5 billion revenue loss. So this is an example to give you like how models are critical and how deployment is so critical. Like if your model doesn't fit into the deployment that you are doing, then it makes very little sense. We have to evaluate this model periodically. So building activity is always continuous. So even if we build a model which is giving well-known doubt, it may not, because the option logistics, in AdTech, the option logistics, the people buying habits change, the seasonal change happen and things happen. So we have to always keep our model up to date, and we have to reevaluate all the machine learning things again and again. Like, for example, the best example is a Netflix example, which they ordered a $1 million price to go to an algorithm, but they could not deploy it to production. The reason was when the competition started, Netflix was a video renting site which was renting DVDs. By the time the competition was over 2 years down the line, they have moved to online streaming business. So even the best model which they had to sell out like $1 million could not be deployed because the trend in the industry has changed. So these are the key points which I think are important, and when you go even like build a model, the important is how to we deploy out of the operationalization. So, yeah, I think that's the major part which I have on our thoughts and learning to talk about the NLP. Thank you.
What next time we use it from finding the rule of
so, there is very stack, so we can use a lot of this program and use it more to find it to the camera. It's very good. It's kind of stable and catchy part of the program. Like, I think it's really, really important to get one of those alarms on the spot.
So, scoring is what you tell me what my current performance is. Do you collaborate? Like, is the story checked or
scoring is when you say my model is scoring this first percent, and you evaluate actually what should be the ideal percentage, what has changed. Like, as I said, will we have base rate to tell us what should be the ideal should be. Like, for example, I wanted to evaluate and say my implementation should by now be 80-90%, but my scoring says my current model is about 60%. So scoring is just what a model has, is what evaluation will say, actually is that model good now in the current time.
Did you get an idea? Or
basic thing is, no, scoring is getting what the current thing is. Scoring is just getting the value. So, for example, my model is performing 80% now. Evaluating this is 80% good.
So this is the decision. Where do we store models? Which database do we use? And what is the average model size we can make?
So it is in GBs, and we don't use any databases storing the model. So we would store some of our data in traditional databases, but none of those need are 20 millisecond or 2 millisecond databases that we have. So all of the data needs to be stored directly. And we have kind of our own custom implementation of our own custom resources cache that has all the data spread. So when you're really at large scale, you can kind of make things, you can kind of tweak a lot of things at the OS level, at the cluster level, and then kind of make those things. So you have one cluster implementation.
So basically, understanding a bit from example, so would for every model, you would be building one model for every advertiser. So that,
so for a buyer or an advertiser, yes, it will be part of the same model, and advertiser will run the features you can figure out who to send it or not. So then you get a single investment and you have two models and you do multiple lookups to figure it out, and then a single investment is sent to multiple advertisers, multiple readers. Yes. These are extremely important because the user knows the particular buyer and they really value that user a lot more. So when you know something more than it, so that particular user, it has a lot of value. Geography is another thing to think about. A lot of advertisers or buyers are total in scale. For example, Pepsi may not care if the user is coming from, but for example, because I don't care if the user is an Indian user, they don't want to score an ad. Probably don't want to score an ad. So let's say,
knowing the user key is extremely important, geography is important,
device types can matter
a lot, whether the device is the user or browser is the user coming from, for example, iOS, for example. So, some signals, you know, what value is the user.
Outside,
yeah.